Well, we had another lengthy discussion of the humanitarian situation in Syria and also the situation in the political process in Syria, which we believe is very relevant and appropriate in the context of the situation there, very grave situation, and the another meeting of the International Syria Support Group, which is to take tomorrow, is to take place tomorrow in Munich. Well, unfortunately, we believe that, you know, you can cross the line between looking seriously and working seriously on humanitarian issues and then crossing into political exploitation of those humanitarian issues. We believe that the Security Council, some members of the Security Council have crossed that line, and they rather crudely use humanitarian matters in order to play, we believe, a destructive role as far as the political process is concerned. You will recall that when the Vienna process was taking place, two meetings of the Vienna group, first on October 30, then on November 14, Russia was arguing for discussing the ceasefire on the ground. Then some members of the group supporting the opposition said that that was not possible, that ceasefire must be only considered in the context of progress in political in a political settlement. Of course, in order to have that progress in a political settlement, you need to have political talks. But as soon as this area the opposition group came to Geneva, they started raising various preconditions, humanitarian and otherwise, in order to avoid sitting at the same table with Staffan de Mistura, let alone the Syrian government. So we have seen it before. Every time there was a serious political effort, there was a huge outcry about one particular area or one particular issue. Was it Holmes or something else on the eve of major meetings, Geneva 1, Geneva 2, we always saw that. So we cannot but regard it as a politically destructive tactics. Now, as to the actions of the Syrian forces supported by the Russian Air Force, you know, our Western colleagues on the eve of Geneva 2 used to say that some balance on the ground must be restored. So if there is some change in the balance on the ground, then that should be taken as a logical development in any armed conflict. Our armed forces, we're not about to be apologetic about what we're doing. We're acting in a very transparent manner. Daily briefings are being conducted by our Ministry of Defense. We are present there legally at the invitation of the Syrian government. In contrast to what the so-called U.S.-led coalition is doing in Syria, where they're acting outside of international law and incidentally never telling anybody what exactly they are doing in Syria or Iraq, what their targets are, what the results of their campaigns are, and also refusing our cooperation to fight terrorists on the ground. And so we think a strategy in the Security Council, the use of time of the Security Council, which could be used better for other purposes rather than having endless meetings on the same situation. Incidentally, now that we see this heightened interest of the Security Council on humanitarian matters, we are prepared to take that up. The Spanish representative said that they are going to convene the seventh meeting of the Council on the humanitarian situation in Syria. So we responded that we are going to propose weekly meetings on the humanitarian situation in Yemen till a political settlement is reached there. And given this heightened interest of the Security Council to humanitarian matters, we need to revisit the humanitarian situation in Libya. You will recall that in late 2011, we raised the issue of the civilian victims of NATO bombings in Libya, only to be rudely rebuffed by our Western colleagues, who said basically, what are you talking about? The mission has been accomplished, the regime has been changed, Gaddafi has been killed. What civilian casualties are you talking about? Despite the fact that High Commissioner for Human Rights, Ms. Pillay at that time, did say in the open session of the Security Council that the issue of civilian casualties must be looked into, and at the very least, apology and compensation should be offered to the families of the victims of those bombings. The Libyan dossier, the Libyan file, was transferred to ICC. We are not aware of any action which has been taken by ICC in order to investigate that. So we propose to hold at some point in the near future a meeting on the humanitarian situation in Libya, inviting Mr. O'Brien, High Commissioner for Human Rights, and a representative of ICC, in order to compare the situation, 2010-2016, I think it would be a very interesting comparison, and also very important to discuss that in light of the current efforts to achieve political settlement in Libya. I also told my colleagues in the Security Council that this propagandistic use of the Syrian humanitarian file is not going to deter Russia from doing the humanitarian work we are doing. With the Syrian government also, we are discussing possible cooperation with the World Food Program. Their initial reaction to our airdrops in Deir ez-Zor was sort of skeptical, if not to say negative, but then we were approached by them, telling us that they think that there is room for practical cooperation between us on those matters. And also we are discussing various possibilities of cooperation, humanitarian cooperation with the United States. So we'll continue to do the actual humanitarian work, and we'll continue to push for a political solution, a speedy resumption of the talks. We're going to do that tomorrow in Munich and in our work in the Security Council. Please.
Ambassador, could you please elaborate a little bit for us on the ceasefire proposals that Russia is going to make tomorrow in Munich? I believe this ceasefire is going to start March 1.
I cannot elaborate something which has not been presented yet.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador. New Zealand and Spanish ambassadors said they called for a humanitarian pause during the closed consultations that were just held. Is this something that Russia supports?
We would be prepared to contemplate all reasonable proposals. But, you know, for those things, talks are required. Talks are required. And unfortunately, there have been humanitarian pauses were announced in Yemen, which collapsed before they started. So you have to have a context for that to be realistic. Simply to announce a humanitarian pause in a situation when there is a lot of fighting, including by terrorist organizations and various other radical organizations, I'm afraid is unrealistic. But to discuss that, of course, as something leading to a long-term permanent ceasefire, we would welcome that discussion.
What are the issues you'd like to see addressed in Yemen? What do you think of the continued airstrikes by the Saudi-led coalition?
Oh, we think, and in fact, you know, I did point out that the military campaign is continuing there. It's not just a Saudi-led coalition. It's a coalition in which the United States and the United Kingdom take a very active part, including, according to numerous media reports, in the targeting by the coalition, and which covers a lot of civilian targets, as we know, including the capital, including the UNESCO-protected areas of the capital of the country. So, I mean, if council members are interested in moving the council to humanitarian discussions, we can do that. So we're looking forward to weekly discussions of the humanitarian, dramatic, disastrous humanitarian situation in Yemen in consultations of the Security Council. Please.
About reports that Turkey and Saudi Arabia are considering sending troops to Syria. I want you to comment about that. And the second question is, have you discussed with Mr. Dimastura the participation of PYD, the Kurds, in the talks? Is that possible from...
Well, first of all, the most important position is that of the Syrian government, which has declared that a military move by Turkey of Saudi Arabia into the Syrian territory will be regarded as an act of aggression. Clearly, that would be a move of serious military escalation, and certainly I don't see how it can help the prospects of a political settlement. Yes, we do believe that as we are preparing for the resumption of the talks, and hopefully even before February 25, additional work needs to be done on making the opposition more representative, not just the Ariad people, which did not exhibit sufficient dedication to the talks, having basically tried to walk out of the talks when Mr. Dimastura announced this pause on the talks, but also the Cairo-Moscow platform and the Syrian Kurds must be represented there. I spoke about that before. For us to discuss the future of Syria, if we are talking about the territorial integrity of Syria, without the Syrian Kurds controlling a large number of the territory, large population, completely it does not make sense at all. So we hope that by the time the talks are reconvened, all those matters would be settled.
Ambassador, yes, Mr. See a chance for the talks to be resumed, especially that the opposition stopped its engagement last time because of the military operations on the ground?
Well, I think that definitely there is a chance, and definitely this is the intention I think, of the responsible members of the international group for support of Syria. It is the intention of the Secretary General, with whom I discussed this matter yesterday. And, well, let's see. We hope that the meeting tomorrow in Munich will help pave the way for a speedy resumption of the talks.
Yes, Mr. Ambassador, the news said that Russia has presented a new peace proposal presented to the American side. Can you share with us some of the elements?
No, I can't. We have a number of discussions with the United States, including the possibility of a ceasefire and also some humanitarian discussions. Very important discussions, too.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador. Are you saying, I realize that you have permission, Russia has permission from the Syrian government for its actions in Aleppo, but are you implying that the opposition to Damascus in the Aleppo area, that they're all terrorists or what?
Well, we're implying that they have been holding large segments of the territory and they have been using their position, among other things, and Turkey has been using that position as a lifeline for terrorists and weapons to come from their territory to the region of Aleppo. So hopefully, if the situation and when the situation is corrected, there will be more optimism for a political settlement. Please.
The Shamia Front, which is an umbrella organization involving most of the armed groups in Syria, which are some of them consider them moderate, have aligned with Nusra and Daesh in the neighborhood of Halab. Now, how would that affect the negotiations with the so-called moderates?
Well, that of course would affect everything very negatively. This is one of the things which I'm sure they are going to discuss tomorrow in Munich, because the idea, as you know, in the course of the Vienna process, was to come up with a joint understanding of who the terrorists are. I mean, everybody agrees that ISIL and al-Nusra and some other groups are terrorists, but there are some other groups which are sort of in the gray area. We may regard them as terrorists. Others refuse to regard them as terrorists. So that is something which is going to be discussed tomorrow, because when we talk about the ceasefire, of course, there can be no ceasefire with terrorists. There can be no ceasefire with ISIL. And this is, I believe, a clear understanding among members of the International Syria Support Group. Thank you very much.
Ambassador.